Hey, oh, hey, oh, hey, oh, hey, oh,
hey!
Welcome!
Welcome to Hype Night, everybody!
Oh my gosh, it's Hype Night already!
It's already Hype Night. It's already Wednesday.
It's been a very cool week.
It's been a very, yeah. Why is that? Was there a holiday?
You know why?
There was no holiday.
No, it's because it's the end of summer.
Yeah.
And we're all like,
no. It's going fast.
Where's it going?
Yeah, it's going away. But I love fall, so I'm one of those people who's like, yeah, bring it on,
no.
Chill wind. I'll take it. I
no.
love it.
I'm just damp and cold and miserable until like December.
Really?
Yeah, I feel cold during the fall than I do in the winter.
In the winter?
Yeah.
Because it's damp for you?
There's dampness, yeah. It's just miserable and damp.
Do you like the light and the leaves, or do you none of it?
Yeah, but let's be honest. That lasts for like 6 days. Everyone's like, but the leaves. I'm like, yeah, but then they fall.
Were you
and
here?
And they rot.
Yeah, but even that is cool.
Awful.
No, I love it.
It's awful.
I'm weird this way. You learn more and more about how much I love
the fall. I got married in the fall.
That's right.
Because I hate the fall.
So you would have something
so
to hold on to?
Yes. Yes.
Feel that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's a testament to your...
It's a little insight there.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, we hope you're enjoying the last days of summer.
Yeah, I hope you are.
Thanks for joining us.
Yes.
If you've been here before, thanks for coming back. If you're new, welcome to Hype Night.
Yeah.
You can like, you can love, you can use all the different emojis. You can share, you can let us know what you're thinking during the show. We'll do our best to... See your comments and ask your questions and all that stuff.
Yeah, we see you watching, we see you commenting.
Whatever.
Yeah. If you don't know anything about Hype Night, Hype Night is a show where we bring on amazing women and we just hype them because they deserve it. And they're awesome.
Yeah,
so
and
there's
we know so many of them.
It's
and
true.
We
and our list is growing and growing.
It's growing and growing.
Yeah.
Maybe we want to do a little demo of what it looks like.
Yeah, okay.
Tonight. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll start with you, Dale.
All right.
Or I guess I'll start.
Okay.
And you're the only other person here, so I'll help you.
Okay.
It sounded weird. I'll start with you.
Okay.
As opposed to nobody else. So Dale, I want to say that you look really scared.
No, I'm not. I'm listening. I'm listening.
My compliment for you this week is that you are a very optimistic person.
Wow.
Like you are so, I am often a very pessimistic person. I have a lot of energy and enthusiasm, so people think that I'm a very positive person. I can be, but then I also can be very doom and gloom. I was raised Catholic and Italian, which sometimes just comes with the territory.
Mm-hmm.
You're very optimistic, and you always have such a positive attitude, and you always find a way to make something work.
That's really nice.
And I really love that about
you,
Dale.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
That's really, really nice. Here's what I'm going to say about you. Are you ready?
Ready as I'll ever be.
You know, I'm never worried about Wednesday nights.
Oh.
I come here, I show up, there's pizza. You know, anything that we have said that is going to happen, you make happen. And it is a pleasure and a joy to be like, oh, I don't have to worry and have the mental load of all these other things because you are responsible enough to do them. And it's great.
Well, thank you, Dale.
So
it's my pleasure.
Yeah.
That's really nice.
Great. That's Hype Night.
That's Hype Night.
That's Hype Night.
Compliments. That's it.
Yeah.
Sharing.
Awesome.
Joy.
Oh my gosh.
Our guest tonight... This is a bit, I suggested this person as I've been a big fan of this person in Toronto politics. My sister used to work at the city. I used to hear a lot about the things going on at the city. Nothing like inside or anything, relax, but just.
Well, probably more so than like, you know, people that aren't connected to it.
I guess so. But mainly I heard about the inner workings of like what day-to-day life is there. And I was always so impressed with this person and I thought, maybe this person would want to come on the show, but I also was like, probably not. Again, as I said before, I'm a bit of a pessimist. So
it's like it's a Facebook live show. It's a new medium, so I get it.
And we got in touch with her office, and they were so wonderful. And they were like, yeah, absolutely. And we couldn't be more thrilled to have her on the show tonight and talk about all the amazing things that she's doing in the city. I think we should bring her on.
Yeah, let's do it.
Get to it. Okay.
Yeah.
So our guest tonight on Hype Night is
Counselor
Kristen Wong-Tam! Welcome.
Oh, no.
Yay! Come on over.
Very excited to be here.
Yay! Welcome!
Oh my gosh.
Really is a thrill.
Yeah.
to have you here.
This is a really cozy place.
It is very cozy. It makes me cozy.
It's because the camera of an iPad only goes this far.
Okay.
Yeah. You can look into either of those, but pretty much there.
Yeah.
Hey, everybody.
Hello, everyone. So welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Thank you, and thank you for having me. I'm actually delighted to be here. You have such infectious positive energy. I'm pretty hyped myself.
Yay! That's so good to hear.
You're in really good company. You can go back and watch all the other episodes of all the other fantastic.
I have been checking it out. Not cyber stalking. It's not a creepy thing. I thought, you know, who else has been on the show?
Yeah.
But nice.
Cool. Great. Well, awesome. Let's start with a drink.
Yeah. Okay. So let's start with a drink. So, yes. We heard that you enjoy a good cranberry juice and a good orange juice, a little mixeroonie.
Yeah, I call it the Bobo.
Oh, the Bobo.
Gosh,
so I like that. I'd like to say I invented it, but I did not. So it's cranberry with just a splash of orange, just to give it a little bit of dynamic movement in the glass. But it's largely because I love citrus, but I also get cankers, which is a bad thing, and the cranberry just sort of takes the edge
off. Man.
Yeah,
you gotta cut out the citrus.
It's not fun, right?
Yeah, no, it's not pleasant. No. But we call it the Bobo because Bobo is actually my nickname.
Is that right?
Yeah, so that's something new for the viewers and for yourself. it actually, in a nutshell, means precious in Chinese.
Okay.
So as a kid, I was just called Bobo. So precious.
That is fantastic.
That is awesome.
Yeah, so.
My nickname that my parents gave me was Squeenoo.
Squeenoo.
Which is short for Skinamarink over the years because I was obsessed with the song when I was a child.
Oh.
So I used to sing Skinamarink all the time, and my mom started calling me Skinamarink, which over the years turned to Squeenoo.
Nice.
Yeah. And if my mom is watching, you can call me Squeenoo whenever you want.
Squeenoo. Bobo.
I don't really think I had a nickname. I guess they called me Melly. Which is not really, it's just an abbreviation.
Is that a splash
that
enough?
That is a splash.
Okay.
Yes.
I feel like someone suggested
right
a nickname
right
for
cue.
Me.
That's the right cue. Okay.
Guys, I have a nickname now. People call me Dags now.
Dags. It's such a good name.
Yeah, because D'Agostino, right? But
nice.
But when I was a kid, I don't know that I had a, I don't think I had a nickname.
There's something hard edge about that.
Dags? Yeah, I like it. I own it. Yeah, sometimes I call myself Dagsy because I was like, it's a little bit bugsy. But really, that's mostly I just did that to myself, so can't really.
That's right.
My own.
Last week we talked a lot about maraschino cherries and my love of them.
Dale loves maraschino cherries,
so
we decided to just garnish with a good maraschino cherry. That's for Matt
Thank
behind
you.
The camera. Thanks, Matt.
So if you're into it, do. If you're not into maraschino cherries and you think that's really weird, you can pop.
It's right here. We have that.
It's all good.
I have not had a maraschino cherry in like decades.
Right.
Well.
And I'm about to. Bring
you're about
to
do
pass.
It. Oh my goodness.
Okay.
Oh my goodness.
They're so good, guys.
Mm.
They're so good.
What do we think? What's the
verdict? I'm not in a rush to do it again.
That's the. I don't know.
That's fair.
That's
fair.
Very fair.
One is plenty.
One is good. Cheers. Thank you for being here.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you.
Cheers. Cheers to you out there.
Two new friends.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed.
I will be eating my other one.
Oh, this
for
is
real.
Nice. I like this with a splash. This is good.
Mm-hmm.
I like it. I like
and
the Bobo.
The cherry actually helps take the tart off.
You have a bit of the stuff swimming around because it's fresh.
That is
just
good.
So you know.
We got the OJ from Fresh, Juice for Life, Fresh Restaurants. Thank you. Fresh.
Plug.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
Plug. There you go. I did do that cherry. Wow.
It's so good.
It's not a like nuanced. It's not an understatement.
It's not nuanced.
It's not subtle.
No.
No, it's not subtle.
Oh,
it grabs you by the throat and goes.
Oh, you're missing ingredients. It's just cranberry with a splash of orange juice. So we're going the other way around.
Splash.
Just a splash.
Just
that's
a splash.
The ingredients today. That's what we're doing in a maraschino cherry.
The Bobo.
The Bobo.
Amazing.
Bobo forever. we're going to start with the best part of your day.
Oh, the best part of my day. Mm-hmm. It's almost on repeat. I have a dog who's 17 years old. And I would say the best part of my day is waking up, looking at her, and seeing her breathe. She's 17, right? So you're so nervous, and every time, you know, everyone tells you, like, 17, why is your dog still alive? And I'm like, because my dog is amazing.
Yeah.
And so I've got so many people convincing me my dog is a miracle dog because she's 17.
What breed of dog?
Yeah.
She's a cockapoo. It sounds very dirty, but
not
it's
amazing.
Basically a cocker spaniel cross.
That kind of dog will last for, like, 17 years.
I would like to think we're going to hit 20. I've looked into cloning her.
Yeah.
And because
amazing.
I love this love this dog so much.
Mm-hmm.
So that's actually literally the best part of my day. I carry her down 6 flights of stairs, and I do that twice in the morning before I actually get to work, because
yep.
she is a 17-year-old dog, which means she needs 6 walks a day.
Yeah.
So
right.
I
yep.
am able to do 2 in the morning, 2 in the evening, and my mom comes in and walks her twice in the afternoon.
That's amazing.
Oh,
that's
so
amazing.
Great.
There is a
17
family
years
support.
Is amazing.
Yeah.
I recently lost my dog.
Yeah.
She was old. She was 11 for a greyhound is very, very old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But like the heartbreak is just so long and it just goes and goes.
Yeah.
So I wish you so many more mornings of waking
yeah.
up and seeing the dog breathing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I'm going to sit Shiva when Francis eventually goes to a better place,
yeah.
doggy heaven.
I basically did.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Basically.
I get you. I feel you.
Yeah. Yeah. But that being said, it wasn't, like, it was hard, but it wasn't
mm-hmm.
horrible and traumatic.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
I'm not, like, PTSD over it.
Right.
It was just awful.
Yeah.
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 I love that was the best
so
part of
it. So it is the best part of my day, and I get to do it 6 times a day.
That's great.
I walk her down the flight of stairs, 6 flights of stairs, and then we go for a walk.
Great.
Oh, nice.
Great.
That's
yeah.
great. The best part of my day actually involves a dog is not my dog. We were driving along DuPont this morning, and there was a car in front of us, a convertible in front of us, and I'm like looking at my phone, and then I look up, and there's a man driving the convertible, and there's a tiny, what looked like a Scotty, just like peeking out the window and like going for a ride in a convertible,
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
it just looked like the happiest dog,
like,
just like living the life,
yeah.
just so happy,
the
wind
dream.
Through
yeah.
its hair.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was so, and it kept like looking around
yeah.
and like looking at everyone in their car. It was really showing off.
Yeah.
And I
look at me in my Benz.
Yeah. yeah.
Being
yeah.
a real dog.
Yeah. It was. It was.
Check me out.
It was a really like delightful, fantastic
oh.
moment, and.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was
the
best part of
it. You know, when people are happy, and even when dogs are happy, I feel so much joy.
I know.
Yeah. Like, you know, it's almost like the laughter of children. It's infectious.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely,
yeah.
yeah.
My best part of the day is I'm going to have a garage sale on the weekend with a friend of mine
mm-hmm.
who has a great yard. I don't have a yard for a garage sale, but she does. So we're going to join forces and have a garage sale. But really what it means is going through my house and kind of curating my house.
Mm.
And it has been so great to be like, I don't need these things in
yeah,
my house.
Yeah.
When you live in downtown Toronto, every square inch is cost so much. So why am I filling
yeah.
it up with stuff?
Yeah.
So I have bags and bags of
yeah.
things that I'm sure nobody wants.
You're
welcome to come on down and check out the garage sale.
Yeah, it's like
yeah.
a material cleanse.
It really is.
Love it.
And
yeah.
it's fine. Like, I'm the kind of person that's like, oh, I remember enjoying this thing.
Yeah.
I can relive it. Okay, bye.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
yeah.
somebody else is going to enjoy it. And
yeah.
with a fresh set of eyes with a whole new purpose.
Yeah. A lot of DVDs in there.
Ooh.
Yeah, the DVD cleanse and
that's
the CD, cool. like all that old media that you...
Yeah.
I mean, we still keep a lot of VHSs because we still have... We talked about this last
mm-hmm.
week, I think, but we still have a VCR. And there's like a bunch that
yeah.
I will always keep. But otherwise, yeah.
There's some things that
cluttery.
You can't find online, like, personally. Like,
yeah.
I can't find the entire season, only 5 episodes, but the entire season of Dave Carvey Show.
Right.
It's an impossible
mm-hmm.
thing to
yeah.
find, so I'm not going to get rid of that.
True mm-hmm. enough.
It's streaming nowhere.
Yeah.
No one is willing.
Streaming nowhere.
Right now.
But you have it.
But I have
you
it.
Have
come
it.
On over.
Yeah, if anyone
yeah.
needs to watch the Dana Carvey Show, Dale's got it.
It's a wonderful
Who
show.
Needs to watch
it's a
movie.
Great
show. No,
I gotta say, we bonded over
this
several episodes ago.
No way.
It was such a funny show.
Yeah.
He was
All right,
was
I shouldn't
so
judge,
funny.
Quite honestly, I haven't seen it.
It's fantastic.
It's really funny.
I
yeah.
reserve judgment.
I'm
going to
send you one of my
it.
Favorite sketches of all time, which is Stephen Colbert and
yes.
Steve
okay.
Carell
yes.
together doing waiters who are nauseated by food.
Yeah.
it's
okay.
a wonderful sketch.
It's a really
yeah.
wonderful
yeah.
sketch. Yeah.
Truly.
All right, I'm there.
Okay,
yeah.
there you go.
Great.
Dana Carvey
That's
fan
good.
Club.
Thank
Dave
you.
Is also the Dana Carvey fan club.
It is. He's fantastic.
We somehow always end up talking
Don't you guys
want to
grow this audience?
It's true.
Drake.
Yeah,
Drake
yeah.
is wonderful.
Drake is also
say
great.
Drake as many times.
Drake. Every
Drake.
We should just hashtag Drake in every post we ever do.
We should.
I think you may not be the only one.
Right?
Trying to
six.
Troll him in such a way.
Six.
The six.
Six.
Yeah.
He's
right.
building
yeah.
his new house, right? In fancy land.
Rite of Path.
Yeah,
that's
Rite
you,
Path,
right?
Yeah.
Is
no,
Rite of Path you?
No, I have the other fancy neighborhood.
Yeah, you have. She has the Shim Sham.
You have the Shim Sham.
Yeah.
I can't wait to talk about the Shim Sham.
Yeah. Dale
okay.
loves to talk about the Shim Sham.
Getting into
right.
that.
Okay.
We're going to do the hype rules. Okay, so they're really, really simple.
Okay.
We're going to have a whole bunch of stuff we're going to chat about how awesome you are. You just take the hype. If we get anything wrong, let us know. And if you want to share some hype, you can share some hype whenever you like. Mm-hmm. So anything you want to share with anyone else. All right. We'll just start.
Okay. Yeah, I'm a little nervous, but I'm ready.
Okay. All right, here we go. I love that on your social media, it says that you are your tagline is progressive, urbanist, unapologetic, champion of all things, #Toronto. I love it.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's pretty great.
Keep
it's
it
so
simple.
Great.
Yes.
Yeah.
And your Ward 27 is your ward.
Mm-hmm.
Which is Centre Rosedale, right?
It's called
Toronto Centre.
Toronto Centre Rosedale.
Okay,
yeah.
Sorry, yeah.
Close.
Okay, yeah. Great. The words confuse me. Like I try to remember what they're called, and I
because
just
when
can't.
You hear
it's,
Toronto,
it's the hyphen.
It's the hyphen.
Yeah,
yeah,
my
absolutely.
Last name
yeah.
messes everybody up.
Well, I have an apostrophe in my last name, and that messes people up.
Oh,
so.
No doubt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Any
cross
kind
borders.
Of right? yeah. Well, funnily enough. I haven't had that much trouble with that.
Oh,
but
nice.
It's mostly just pronunciation. Literally, people see it and stop. Like, they don't.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Not to
yeah.
do it. I either
yeah.
get, my mind goes either way. Boyer or Boye.
Or Boye.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah. Boyer,
so it all
Boyer.
Depends on, I think, what your own background is with that name.
That's right.
And then people go, Boyer. Mm, okay, whatever. It's fine.
It
doesn't,
I'm in.
It doesn't really matter
yeah,
to me.
Deal.
Either one.
yeah.
yeah. I just get mistaken because I have two names that kind of sound masculine, so I get mistaken a lot. Like, I'll be sitting in waiting rooms and I'm like, oh, I know what's happening.
Yeah.
My massage is 10
You've been
minutes
misgendered.
Because I've been misgendered.
Right.
So,
yeah.
and I'll be like, I'm Dale. And they're
yeah.
like, oh, of course you are. Yep.
Yeah.
Just hang on a second. I'm like,
yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Yeah,
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 yeah.
yeah I know what I'm doing.
Yeah, you're waiting for someone else. Yeah, but it's confusing though, because when I hear Toronto Centre, I think Toronto Centre,
mm-hmm.
but it's like from almost
St.
Clair all the way down to Queen Street.
Yeah.
yeah, it starts at Mount Pleasant Cemetery.
Yeah,
so
right.
you're at the bottom of the cemetery and you go all the way down to Queen Street. So
mm-hmm.
between the Hudson Bay and Eaton Centre, that is pretty much the ward. 14 residential neighborhoods, five
wow.
big business districts.
Crazy.
I call it the heart of the city, largely because like everything that happens in Toronto feels like it's happening right downtown.
Yeah.
Yes.
And my ward is probably the most urban of all of this, all of Toronto.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's such
yeah.
a wide set
but
of demographics.
But it has Rosedale
there.
In it, and you go, oh, Rosedale.
Hey, you know what? Rosedale is a beautiful neighborhood.
It is.
It's
gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
It's
gorgeous.
But it's also
so
got some of our most natural ravine systems.
Yes.
They're
yes.
gorgeous.
So can I
yeah.
talk to you about what we
the
like Shim to
Sham?
Call the Shimsham, Rosedale
yeah.
Valley Road?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It was coined by Marco Timpano and Amanda Barker as the Shimsham. It
yeah.
is, I kind of almost don't want to talk about it because it's like a secret.
That we
it's
call it the Shim Sham?
No,
you
it's
you
a
want
secret.
To keep
secret. Oh, yeah.
I kind of don't want people to use it.
Yeah, I feel the same way. It's such a magical drive,
mm-hmm.
rock,
right.
cycle,
quickly.
Anything.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
yes.
And it gets you there quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah. yeah.
And now you can turn left. You can turn left when you're going north on Bayview.
Yeah.
When I saw that, I started tweeting everybody
it's
being like, you don't know. I don't have to go up to the DVP, go down, and then go back.
Yeah.
I
yeah.
can just turn left.
That is so inside Toronto baseball.
It is.
It totally is.
But
yeah.
if you know the Shim Sham,
yeah.
you know what I'm talking about.
You know
about.
That Shim Sham.
And now you know it too.
Is there that's any like lore or legend about the Shim Sham? Is there any like weirdness about it that I want to know? It's just such
know.
A secret. I want to write a movie about it, to be
let's
very
write
honest.
A, yeah, that's a good idea.
Like my husband and I have been talking about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I could actually go into that
it's,
like,
into the lore
here
of it?
At this moment.
Yeah.
yeah.
Okay.
But
cool.
I can say that the locals will tell you that there's all sorts of ways to get through the neighborhood.
Right.
And they're not going to tell you how to do it.
Exactly.
Like,
that's fair.
It's one of those few neighborhoods that actually don't want the new Toronto signs, you know, which are blue and
yeah, yeah.
and white. They're very large, somewhat utilitarian looking.
Mm-hmm.
In Rosedale, we keep the old acorn signs. You know the ones with the little knob on top?
Yeah,
because,
with the little...
Yeah,
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 because they're like, we don't want you to change our signs because we like the old heritage Toronto
I
look.
Get that, though.
Yeah.
Totally.
I
yeah.
absolutely
yeah, I
get
that.
That.
So for sure, it's definitely one of the most desirable neighborhoods and,
yeah.
and not even just Toronto, but across the country. But there's a certain stewardship from the residents on how they take care of the natural environment.
Yeah.
Mm.
And even the fact that it's got to be, that the houses have got to be in this park-like setting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I get that.
Cool.
I'm kind
that's
of
cool.
in the
yeah,
middle
yeah.
between like beaches and Leslieville, I suppose.
Yeah.
And there's definitely a sense there too, of like people trying to keep the that sense,
yeah.
that beachy sense.
Mm-hmm.
I said
mm-hmm.
beaches, which is right off the bat.
You
wrong.
Are
yeah.
so wrong.
Yeah.
I
you're correct. How do
you
yeah. live there?
Being
they're gonna
right
be
beach.
They're gonna annex you. You're gonna
there's,
go there and
there's
they're
only
gonna
one
be
beach.
Like, no.
Just the beach.
Just the beach.
Just the beach.
Yeah.
But I'm like, yeah. So, but I get it because there's always like a talk of like what's happening and how it should
yeah,
look and,
yeah.
and everything.
I like that though. I'm always really happy when I see people really try to protect old Toronto landmarks and neighborhoods and green spaces, and you do a lot of work in terms of green spaces, and I just think that's really important because it's really easy with all the development that's happening for that to go by the wayside. So it's it's advocates for that, and people who love their neighborhoods. Like I love my neighborhood. I live in Bloor Court and really love it. So
there's a real a sort of like eclectic dynamism there, right? So and it sort of rolls out through the 140 neighborhoods of Toronto. Every single one of them is so different and unique.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
So
yeah.
It's good.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, I'm in your ward a lot.
Yeah.
I'm in your ward all the time.
You have 400,000 people during
right?
the daytime. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
We have two universities, and that keeps it, keep us hopping.
Yeah, right, Ryerson.
And, about five hospitals for reasons.
Yeah,
because
you're University Health Network. You're right there. Yeah.
Yeah. So
it
ends up being a pretty exciting place, and not to mention the fact that it's a major employment zone. So we have people traveling from all from the edges of Toronto, but even across the region who come right downtown to work.
Yeah.
So everyone is welcome.
Yay!
Yay.
You belong here.
Come see us. Be here.
You're a founding member of the Church and Wellesley Village Business Improvement Association.
Yes, I did that.
Okay, good for you.
Yeah.
Well done.
You told me to accept the
gift. Yeah, that's it. That's how you do it, everybody.
I was just told you to accept that.
That's it. A whole bunch of people had to get together and make that happen. You were part of it. That's awesome.
Yeah,
great.
Yeah, fantastic.
And you were a real estate professional before going into politics?
Yeah, I worked in real estate financial services for 16 years. So it was actually a pretty interesting career. And I did it at a time when I think a lot of folks today will have a job for, or at least they'll move into one career and then a couple years later they'll shift elsewhere. But I had a career for 16 years, and I owned a few small businesses, and it was actually really interesting because I love people. I got to really enjoy and get to know the city because you don't get to stay in one spot, and I really got to see the very best of Toronto. Yeah.
And
cool.
It's probably helping with, and I feel like this is happening right now.
Yeah,
there's this like crazy tax. Property tax is happening, right? On Yonge Street?
Yeah.
So has that been, like, to kind of resolved and dealt with? Because what I just read was that it was still kind of all up in the air.
It is. It's certainly a conversation still in flux. So there are about 80 properties in the Heritage Conservation District of Yonge Street that was hit with some wild big assessments, which meant that their property taxes, like, went through the roof.
Yeah.
100 to 400% massive increase. Nobody can survive that.
No, it's crazy town.
Yeah.
So here's my question.
Yeah.
Not knowing much or anything about it.
Sure.
You know, I buy my house. I have a house. I'm fortunate enough to have been able to do that. You know, and my house gets reassessed. And then I go, okay, my taxes are going to go up because my house gets reassessed, right?
Yeah.
But then it goes up based on what my house was assessed at.
Mm-hmm.
But that didn't go up like boom, like just one big crack. Is that what's happening here? Or are we talking about like 200% increases like
all at once
at a week every year?
So
or?
Properties are assessed in Ontario every 4 years.
Okay.
And generally what happens then is that you get a new tax assessment based on your value of the property. There's a mill rate that's applied by the city, which is your tax rate. And then that comes out your property taxes for that period of time. And then it's spread out over 4 years. So you get to pay it out over four installments annually. And when you see those big, massive assessment jumps, most people are not prepared for it, especially the mom and pop, small, medium-sized operators.
Yeah.
It's already very difficult to make ends meet for small business because, you know, the cost of occupancy is high. Sometimes they'll tell you that the labor cost is very high, and the margins for profit are just being, you know, basically shaved away.
Mm-hmm.
So in a nutshell, you're not going to be able to withstand that sort of big jump in any type of unanticipated costs.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, it's property taxes. So the property owners needed some relief. We went to bat for them. We brought the Municipal Assessment Property Assessment Corporation to the table and said, look, we think you've made a mistake. You need to sort of take a more nuanced approach to appraising these properties. And to their great credit, they said, okay, we think we made a mistake too. We're willing to reassess. So these property owners are going to be given a chance.
By
middle of
huge.
September, they will get a new assessment bill, and hopefully that will allow us to give them some tax relief.
Mm-hmm.
Which is
people like a heads up. Oh my gosh, or a way to be able to plan for even that it's happening. Because when I was reading about that, you know, I heard about it in the news, and then I was like, oh, wait a second, you have something to do with helping to give mm-hmm. this relief. So that's amazing, because a lot of people just get done to.
No,
you know?
We're working on it, and yeah. it's so much more complicated than what I just summarized. But
right.
I think that the hard work's
thank
got
you
it
for
done.
Keeping it simple.
Yes,
for
I was like, great, I could follow it. Thank you.
I'm
more
like,
bobo.
I'm like, I pay taxes. You know,
yeah.
Well, that's amazing that they're rethinking that and reassessing that
yeah,
situation.
Yeah, and people love Yonge Street. Everyone's
yes.
got an emotional attachment to Yonge Street.
Yeah.
People still tell me this is where they bought their records and, you know, how they fell in love and they had their first kiss
mm-hmm.
and under a certain, you know, street sign or perhaps an intersection. Their first date was at the theaters or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there is this very strong emotional connection to Yonge Street. Everybody knows it. And it's and so when something bad happens on Yonge Street, we all want it to be fixed.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
funny
of
though
course.
Too, because when I was a kid, Yonge Street was like, scary. it was
oh, yeah.
like the '80s, right?
Yeah.
Like it was
mm-hmm.
like I remember
yeah.
my grandfather used to work for the city, and sometimes he would just like take you out for a drive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He would just
yeah,
take
yeah,
you
yeah.
out for a drive and go see the lights or Christmas lights. That's a thing we used to do.
Yeah.
Do people still do that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Go for,
yeah. They
drive?
Still do that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
So, but I remember Yonge Street was always like. Grittier than
yeah.
than it was now.
Yeah.
And it's funny because it's like even with that, people have their you know their experiences and their memories. But now it's just everybody. It's still such a thriving, wonderful place
oh,
that
yeah.
people have all their. They'll be like,
yeah.
I was a young and desperate and I had my first kiss. It's kind of amazing.
Well,
yeah.
it's also the busiest street, not just in Toronto but in Canada, with 20 million people walking north and south. Every single year, so
wow.
it is. It's a street that has that evokes all sorts of strong emotions,
yeah.
and I think even an intellectual connection. So there's strong music history and legacy that's
yep.
there. There's yeah. obviously it's seen every major protest and demonstration of political resistance.
Yeah, that's
mm-hmm.
true.
Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And whenever any of our sports team win, you know. It happens on Yonge Street.
Yeah.
The parade is on Yonge Street.
Yeah.
So it's clearly Toronto's main street.
Yeah.
yeah.
I love
Yonge Street.
I'd love
yeah.
to drive all of Yonge Street though. I'd love to do it. I'd love to just go for like all the way.
I'd love to bike it to be quite honest.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
yeah. So
yeah.
it would be an epic ride, but
yeah.
I feel like there's some rolling hills to climb, but
yeah.
it'd be worth it
yeah.
to make it to the top.
Yeah.
You do so much cycling, right? I just have seen your Twitter has been
your Twitter's like
so much cycling.
I have to admit, it might be a little bit too much cycling at the moment. Some of my residents are like, would you please stop talking about cycling? But I can't because I love it.
Yeah.
I love that you talk about cycling.
I love it too.
I'm a Toronto resident who I think it's very scary. I think the idea
yeah.
of cycling is very scary. I wish I could do it without being afraid.
I used to cycle. I used
yeah.
to cycle to work and,
yeah.
and I worked in catering, so I would work long shifts and it'd be 2 a.m. and I would love biking home after my
mm-hmm.
shift. There was something
it's
about
fast.
The city. Like
yeah.
and also there's biking in the city first thing in the morning or like late at night, there's something amazing about it because
yeah.
it's quiet and you're
yeah.
it's really freeing.
Yeah.
But I stopped because I started to feel a little bit overwhelmed
yeah,
by some of the intersections, especially right in the downtown core.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this past weekend on Sunday, we had our Open Streets program.
I love Open Streets.
Which is an amazing program.
Yes.
So cool.
We basically open up Toronto streets to people, and we temporarily close them on a Sunday morning to cars. And I had the, I have one constituent who actually gave me the happiest smile that day. Like, she just put a mega smile on my face. She tweeted at me and said, you know, she had been living in the city for about 8 or 9 years, and she had not been on a bike, but she got on that bike that one time because of Open Streets, because the streets felt safe.
yeah.
Bike Share
yeah.
Toronto gave her a free bike, and Open Streets allowed it to happen.
Love it.
So I was like, that is the best thing that happened to me on Sunday.
Yeah.
That's
awesome.
Fantastic.
We strolled through Open Streets. We love it. It's in our neighborhood from
yeah.
like around Christie
yeah.
to, and we walked east, and we just walked and picked up some stuff at a local like fruit stand, like a fruit
yeah.
market, and like it's just the best. There's something about those streets being open
yeah.
and people change, like the way they interact with other people.
They're smiling.
It's like, yeah, they're making
so
eye contact in a
yeah.
different way. It's a really great initiative.
Yeah.
And
there's over 200 Open Streets program around the world. Toronto still has a very modest one. It's only been our fourth year.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have the potential to building the world's best Open Streets program, because Open Streets in cities where they're held in iconic neighborhoods, like quality neighborhoods, producing these amazing experiences, you get the overall best feeling of the city.
Mm-hmm.
It's free. It's all physical health focus.
Yeah.
And you can never tell who's rich or poor on a bicycle or a skateboard. And it's great family fun. And we don't have to build another community center in the city. Like, you just take over your street and you just go out and exercise.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah, I love it.
That.
It's great. Next year I'll come.
Yay.
I didn't come this year.
Yeah. Well, there is one more opportunity this year.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So our next Open Streets program is launched on Sunday, September the 17th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m.
All right.
That's it.
You heard it.
You heard it here.
Yes.
You can do it.
Yep.
Maybe I'll bring my bike.
No excuse.
I'll bring my bike.
I'll bring the Bobo.
There you go. Bobo.
Yes.
Bikes and Bobo.
Great. So, listen, hype, when, you know, we do hype night, try to keep it positive. I always... You know, that's our thing. We keep it positive.
But we're both really struck by this one article, so
I think
we want to bring it up.
I think
right?
so too.
Okay,
it's a pinned tweet for you.
Yeah.
And it's a thing you wrote about the budget and women being missing in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's an older thing that you wrote up. Well, not that much older, a few months.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a pinned tweet, and I read it. And you know, listen, I'm so thankful for you to write down those words and put
mm-hmm.
them all in one place.
Mm-hmm.
I encourage everybody to go and read it, and we'll put the link up here. It's just basically about the Toronto budget and how it's not as gender responsive as we would have hoped.
And it was fascinating to read about the... I had never really heard of a gender responsive budget as an entity that was
mm-hmm.
Referred to. And so it was originally developed to address gender bias in budgeting, from what I can understand. And I found it fascinating, all the data around how effective it is to
mm-hmm.
look at budgets this way.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And how disappointing it is that our budget really wasn't looked at through that lens necessarily.
No, and I think, you know, one of the great things about Toronto is that we're this amazing social experiment. There's a lot of social development and policy that continues to evolve. We may not get it right the first time around, and certainly we tried this in 2017, where I asked city staff to put forth a gender equity lens, place it over the budget, because I think that the budget is the apex of all policy tools. You can have all sorts of planning documents, and you can have all sorts of government policies that drive the quality of service and service delivery, but none of that will actually make any difference unless you assign it to a line item on a budget.
Sure.
So
yes,
it has to be sourced
yeah.
with funding. And so we didn't quite get to a gender responsive budget in 2017, and clearly my article reflected that. I said, you know, we didn't do a good job. But I'm hoping that in 2018 we take another stab at it.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because if Toronto is able to truly create a gender responsive budget for both the operating and the capital budget, then we will be the first city in North America to truly have a true gender responsive budget. So
amazing.
Even Prime Minister Trudeau, who says he himself is a feminist, has made sure that the federal budget has at least some statements and some qualifiers about gender equity.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've looked at it from a gender impact lens. They want to make sure that the budget is going to remove discrimination and barriers so that
mm-hmm.
men and women, boys and girls, are treated equally. And not only is that just the right thing to do, it's actually, it makes the most business sense.
It does.
Yes,
right?
It does.
And that's the thing. It's
yeah.
like, it's a harder,
mm-hmm.
it's easy to say, oh, we'll do this and this will cost that and this will cost this, but having just going through the article, for example, it's like you always hear that it's like with the support of mothers and parents to be able to have, you know, appropriate care for their children, and all this brings them an ability to be able to work and, you know, have money for the economy and pay their taxes and all of those things. And you hear it and it totally makes sense.
Yes.
But then on a budget line, you're like, this is crazy. How could this be? We can't spend this much on this support and this kind of thing. But the dollar amounts back, it makes perfect sense. So
yeah,
and the business case is there for
mm-hmm.
for the time and money that you spend on improving women's empowerment and economic opportunities for developing them for women. They go back into the workforce, they develop a salary, and they pay their taxes, and the cycle of poverty is eliminated.
Gorgeous.
And then the wealth
yeah.
creation grows for everyone.
Oh,
it's gorgeous.
So good. So is
yeah.
this is a thing then that we can help to encourage our counselors to support this? Is this something
yeah.
we can,
if we
support it, then we can.
That's
not
right.
that you don't need to endorse that, but I can say
yeah.
that if you do support it and you want, I say take a look at the article and advocate for as much
yep.
intersectionality and a change in our perspective as we can, right?
Yeah, gender responsive budgeting.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So there you go. Now you've heard it. Some people are watching live. Some people are listening to this in their cars. Other people will listen to it tomorrow as they work. So mm-hmm. everybody has an opportunity to kind of look at it. And you know, the thing is, it's hard, I find, sometimes to always be like super engaged with my counselor. Like I feel like all the time I'm like, what have you heard? Yeah. But there are times to do it, and I think that this is one. So
okay.
So
yeah. Cool.
Thank
Love
you.
It.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Okay. Look at, here's your big stuff.
Yeah,
we got like all this big stuff.
So you were the past president of the Chinese Canadian National Council Toronto chapter.
Yes, that's
so
a mouthful.
So many words.
Lefty progressive organizations need to find
shorter titles. Please, we want to talk about you. We don't have time because
we ran out of space and the characters.
That's right.
Yeah.
But that organization helped to successfully lobby the federal government for the head tax apology and redress, which
mm-hmm.
I didn't even. This was a whole interesting thing to research that I didn't really know about, where immigrants, Chinese immigrants who came here after the railroad was built, were then charged a tax
mm-hmm.
to come here. And there's stuff about our history as Canadians and Torontonians and Ontarians that I really feel we don't know about
mm-hmm.
until we're really pointed to it. And so I was grateful to know about this, and also grateful to hear that there was an apology and a redress that happened through the work of this organization.
Mm-hmm.
So that's amazing.
Yeah, and it was actually a very emotional time for me when I was in the Senate chambers. I was sitting in Senator Nancy Ruth's chambers at that time, and Prime Minister Harper was standing before the House, and all the party leaders were basically taking turns acknowledging that it was the right thing to do. It was an all-parliamentary, all-party endorsed apology. And I have to say that there were some head taxpayers, and there aren't too many left because many of them have passed away, who never lived to see the apology. But the few that were there, it was incredibly moving. And certainly some of their spouses were there. And I just wept. And I couldn't believe that this campaign that took us like close to 20 years to mount, 25 for some, had finally resulted in what was a meaningful apology. And a very modest redress amount, like $20,000 for the head taxpayer who was still alive, or $20,000 to their surviving spouse. But at that time, when they paid the head tax, the quantum was $500. And back in those days, we're talking about the 1930s, and that was the equivalent of 2 years' wages.
Yeah.
And so
crazy.
I stood up proud in the red chamber, and I was proud to be a Canadian. And at that point in time, I was like, you know, Canada's my home.
Mm-hmm.
But I needed that as someone who actually was born overseas, who understands the immigration story of Chinese people, recognizing that there was this racist legislation that was only imposed on people of Chinese heritage. It was also a very shameful chapter of our history,
mm-hmm.
which has now been, of course, remedied. And so this is why Canada is this amazing social miracle, and we have a responsibility to make it better by advocating the very best for our country.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And just
that's a hype to that.
Hype to that.
That's an amazing
to the Bobo.
Yes.
But you know, the thing is, it's like you can spend 20
to Canada.
To Canada,
mm-hmm.
indeed.
Yeah.
You know, you can spend 20 years to do that, and it finally comes and. To be able to have something like that happen just makes it more available to have it continue to happen for all the different
yes.
things that we should be, you know, learning about and finding out about and having addressed.
Yes.
And apologized and addressed.
Yeah.
So, because there's a lot of history in our country that I just don't know, and every time I hear about it, I'm like, what?
I know. I really had no idea
yeah.
about this, and I was, it was really interesting to read about it, and I was happy that it had a positive ending,
mm-hmm.
Or at least as positive as
yeah.
it could be for those who are still around and their families, who I'm sure also felt
mm-hmm.
the impact of that.
Yeah.
Because there's a legacy there, right? Like, we feel those things through the generations,
that's
those
right.
injustices,
yep.
and when they are addressed, we feel that too.
Yeah.
And so that's huge.
Which I think in many ways, which is why I have so much empathy. I mean, not that it's the same narrative, but for Indigenous people,
yes.
you know, the first people of Canada, the Inuit, the Métis, and Indigenous people, is that, you know, there's been so much systemic racism, the effects of colonialism,
mm-hmm.
And we have an opportunity, especially in Canada's 150th, you know, sesquicentennial, to really do the very best we can to not just understand the truth, which is still you know, making its way through the heads of and hearts of Canadians. But you know, ask ourselves, what does true expressions of reconciliation look like?
Yes.
And how can we as Canadians, you know, do the best that we can to you know, challenge our government, challenge those structures of racism, and do right by Indigenous people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Got a goosebump.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I actually got a goosebump. Cause I feel like we've been talking about so much, and I want to also just give you a side hype here for being able to say
sesquicentennial.
I couldn't say eclectic earlier, so I made up for
you,
that.
Yeah, you more than made up for it with sesquicentennial.
But every time we, you know, every time we hear these things and we address them and we talk about them, it opens our ears to be able to hear it without judgment and without, you know, putting on the brakes and being able to be like, oh, but I've never heard that. How could that be? That can't, I can't, or it was done. It was another time, and it was done for this reason or for that
reason.
And
the reframing, the ability to reframe our history and go, actually, let's look at what really went down. Let's look at it in through a different lens.
Yeah.
And now as more Indigenous people, as we're hearing from more and more of them, the more we give them a platform, the more we'll understand about their experience.
Yeah.
So,
I know this year has... deeply, it's a long learning process, but it's deeply beginning to ingrain for me to listen and listen and listen as a totally privileged white woman, you know, who's had many generations in Canada, and just like, it is time for me to listen, and it feels good to now that I'm like letting over to it.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm opinionated and I like to talk about things and I like to challenge things, but the truth is to be able to go, no, just listen is beautiful, really.
And to listen not just with our ears but also our heart. And I think one of the things I've learned working with Indigenous communities is that, you know, we have to be able to create the circle wide enough that everybody has a chance to be there. And for sure there is a lot of pain, but there's also a lot of great reasons to celebrate. It's one of the fastest. They're one of the fastest populations in Toronto in terms of, you know, Indigenous people coming in from rural communities or perhaps from reserves. Certainly, they're graduating from universities in record numbers, and they are ready to lead. I mean, I meet young Indigenous leaders who are just like, I'm here. I need to be counted, and they're not shying away from culture, and they're interested in having those tough conversations. And it's also about the modernity. Like, this is about defining Indigenous, you know, excellence for the next 150 years.
Yes.
And that's where the community is, in you know, in some ways. So yeah, for sure, there's the struggle, but then there's also the great reasons to celebrate.
Yeah. It's interesting because I went to school. I went to high school, Jane and Falstaff, which is just south of Jane and Finch. It was a really, really diverse neighborhood, and it was, you know, so many different cultures and so many different types of people, so many languages. At one point, we were like, this high school that I went to was the most different countries represented in a school in Canada.
Oh, wow.
Like, it was just like this hugely, and I don't remember one Indigenous person in my school. So it was interesting because I had this like upbringing of all this surrounding and all this culture and all these immigrants, and most of the people that I went to school with were immigrant families, first generation families. And then I got in, I went to school, I went on, and I was like, oh my gosh, you know what? I know so very little about my own country and... you know, Indigenous communities and stuff, because I was right in the middle of Toronto. Well, I was in North York, but you know, in that sense, I was very in the middle of this other experience. That it's, I feel like I'm coming to it later in my life.
But you're not the only Canadian. I think what ends up happening is we're all poor for it.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yes, absolutely.
Without that deep, you know, human connection and the I really see you, not just I think you're there, but I see you, I hear you. We become richer as people because our relationships deepen.
Yes.
I'm taking a drink to that too.
It's a bliss. It's hype. Sometimes the hype is hard.
Yeah,
but
sometimes.
Pardon
the hype sometimes. I'm curious because you speak with such passion and you represent so many different people in such wonderful ways. I'm curious if you always knew you were headed toward politics, or if this was how you came to know that this was how you wanted to impact the world and the city.
No, I definitely didn't think I had a future in politics, and if anything, it was not an option that I even felt like was available to me. So I was doing fairly well in my life. I had a very successful career. I was able to, you know, do my activism and, you know, take my vacations. And I thought that that was the journey. And I knew that there was probably a few more businesses I would like to open because I'm very entrepreneurial.
Mm-hmm.
But then I had a slight detour. And in 2010, I was contemplating, should I try to take a run for Councillor Calray's seat at that time, who
right.
announced that he was leaving. And when he did announce he was retiring, I had my phone was ringing, and I had friends who said, you know, you've always complained about certain things, and we are all whiners, right? Even politicians, we whine.
Right.
Why we get into politics? We want to change things. We want to make
right.
it better. And I remember thinking, no, that's not me, because that boy, do they work too hard? And I thought that's not enough. You know, I think that there's something else I can do. So I didn't think it was an option, and then I, you know, was asked to reevaluate, and my friends threw me a big surprise party, and the big surprise party was with 50 people. There was a massive banner hanging at Scallywags on St. Clair, and basically the banner read KWT for 2010. And at that point in time, I was looking at my partner, and I was looking at this room full of people, and all my friends were saying, you should do it. You have to do it. So I stood on the window ledge of Scallywag, the pub,
yeah.
and I gave my first rambling, just as I am now, impromptu speech, and saying, you know, if I'm going to try to do this and get myself to City Hall, you're going to come with me, because I'm going to throw the front doors, back doors, side doors, windows open. You're all coming with me. And that's how I stepped into the political arena and fought a very tough first election.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
and
amazing.
You do work too hard because it's 9 o'clock on a Wednesday.
And you're here with us.
You're here. That's working
so
hard.
Well, this doesn't feel like work.
Oh, still.
This is a lot of fun. If it looks like fun, I tell you it is fun.
Hey, okay. I think it's time for a little... Is it time for a lightning round or do you
yeah.
have something else?
No, I'm warming my tongue up
okay,
for a lightning round.
Here's
it's
a little lightning
on.
Round of all of the council's committees and other boards that we could find that you are on. So let's get ready for tongue
Ooh.
Twisters and
all
long
right.
names.
All right. The Toronto and East York Community Council. You're the chair of that one.
The Planning and Growth Management Committee.
Disability Access and Inclusion Advisory Committee.
Moss Park and Ted Reeverina Nominating Panel.
Toronto Preservation Board.
Preservation.
The Toronto Eclectic Board.
The 519 Church Street Community Center Board of Management. I love the 519. Hype to the 519.
Good Neighbors Club Board.
Moss Park Arena Board.
Ryerson Center Board of Directors.
Salvation Army Toronto Grace Health Center Board of Trustees.
Young Dundas Square Board of Management.
Board member of the University of Toronto Arts Center.
Business chair at the Toronto Workforce Innovation Group, previously known as the Toronto Training Board.
St. Lawrence Center for the Performing Arts Board of Management. And then you're a part of all of these BIAs,
like
or you at some point have been.
Bloor Street BIA.
The Bloor Yorkville BIA.
Church Wellesley Village BIA.
The Downtown Young BIA.
Rosedale Main Street BIA.
I feel like we're saying it like we're car salesmen. It's like, come down to the Young Street BIA.
One of those
the hand thing? Yeah, the like.
That list may be updated, but it's pretty accurate.
This is like enormous.
We might have even
yeah.
missed a couple.
I'm
but,
sure we did.
Yeah. So
yeah.
you do a lot of stuff. You do a lot
of
stuff.
I'm assigned a lot of work. And
yeah.
board appointments, apparently.
Yeah.
Well, it's probably because you get it done, right? If you didn't get it done, everyone would be like, uh-oh.
Yeah.
You better not do that.
Yeah.
Put the workhorse on the board.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well,
It's okay.
It's okay.
It's all good.
It's good for them. I mean, all of these people are very, all of these boards are very lucky to have you on their board.
They do also need to shorten their name.
The old, yeah, I think that's a good advice. You have good advice.
Yeah.
Advice. Yeah.
PGMC,
DAI. No, they're just acronyms, but they're like 12 letters.
DCPMGA. Again, we run out of characters.
Yeah,
it's yeah exactly.
Yeah.
If you were trying to put this on, you can't even Twitter it.
You can't tweet it.
Oh, by the way, your social media is
yeah.
amazing.
Is on point. Oh.
Okay, so
yeah.
just know that it's
Thank
outstanding. You.
You should
really follow her because it's really great.
Yeah, you can follow her at Councillor Kristen Wong Tam is her Facebook. Twitter is at Kristen Wong Tam. Website, you can go to ward27news.ca.
Yeah.
There's all kinds
yeah.
of news on there.
I mean, you can just Google her.
Just You're going to find all kinds of amazing things. Just Google her. Thanks, everybody who's been following along. I think we have some people. Laura Javelee Johnson's following. Hey, Laura.
Yep.
Hype to you.
There's lots of stuff going on here. Sonia D'Agostino is saying hello.
Hype to Sonia D'Agostino.
And Margaret,
who actually put me in touch with your people. So
okay.
Thank you to Sonia for making
thank
it
you,
connect.
Sonia.
Yay.
And then I feel like this is bringing us to the end
I
of our hype
is.
Night.
Yeah.
Wow.
Sadly.
The time went by so
quickly. I know.
Yes.
It goes by so quickly.
It flies by.
Yeah.
We didn't even talk about, like, coffee or anything.
I know. She has a lot about coffee. So
I went to coffee college.
Yeah, she went to coffee college, everybody.
I know.
I didn't even know there was a coffee college.
It was a real thing.
I want to go to coffee college.
I know.
Real bad.
Yeah. You probably could. You could probably
I'm
go.
Self-taught. No big deal.
Homeschooled.
Deals, coffee, homeschooled.
Yeah, come on over, I'll make you a Bialetti and we'll enjoy it.
Oh,
yeah,
nice. So Bialetti, old school.
Oh,
I like
stovetop. On stovetop, yeah.
Nice.
It makes the best coffee.
It
too.
Does,
right?
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah. Amazing. Next week on Hype Night, we have Amanda Barker.
Oh, my gosh.
You know, yeah, right? Amanda
yes.
Barker, comedian, writer, actor, radio host. Incredible gal.
Wonderful thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we look forward to that. We thank you so much for being on the show.
The pleasure is all mine.
Yay. Yeah. We look forward to seeing all your activity on social media.
Yeah. I will follow you guys.
Yay!
Sure.
And we thank all of you for joining us and sharing. And if you want to review us or rate us, please go for it.
Yeah, we're into it.
We're into it. We appreciate
really
you. We are. And have a good night. Enjoy your bobo.
And now we're going to go out on open source music. Thank you.
Thank you, open source music.
Always. Thank you.
Oh man,
I still love this drink.
It's so good, it's so refreshing.